Shabbat shalom, everyone. Shabbat shalom. I'm going to go ahead and stand. Thank God it's not as warm in here today, right? And I don't think we've fixed the problem yet. It's not. It's coming. It's coming. So make sure you keep as a faithful giver because it's supporting the change of temperature in this room. But thank God God has given us a little reprieve this week and it feels a little cooler. Before we get started, can you make sure you silence your cell phones at this time? Check your phone and make sure it's on silent. That would also include iPads that can possibly make noises or rings or get reception if it's a cellular iPad or tablet. So check your cell phone, make sure it's on silent or off as we get ready to stand and cover ourselves in the commandment of Tzitzit. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Asher Kitchanu B'mitzvota V'tzivanu V'hitotet Batzitzit. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments, has commanded us to wrap regarding wrapping ourselves to the seas. Amen.
And at this time, we shall have Yohanan ben Yehuda and Dami ben Yaakov sound the shofar. And with that, if you could say with me, that's the blessing for the shofar sound.
Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Asher Kishanu B'mitzvota V'tzivanu Lishmoa Kol HaShofar.
Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe,
who has sanctified us with his commandments, commanded us to hear the sound of the shofar.
Amen. Our Father, our King, we thank you, Lord God, for surrounding us with a hedge of protection, keeping us safe at all hours of the day. Lord God, morning, afternoon, and evening, Lord God, as you receive our prayers early in the morning when we seek you. And Father, as we also not only pray like Abraham early in the morning, but in the afternoon like Isaac, and in the night evening season like Jacob, we thank you, Lord God, that we can encounter you, Father. Father, even the ladder that he saw from heaven to earth, we know angels ascending and descending because they're with us. They're going up to heaven, coming back down with the message. And Father, we thank you that we're hearing the message today of your Torah, the message you gave the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the message you continue to reveal through Moshe. And Father, we pray today through Yeshua the Messiah, the ultimate fulfillment of Torah is not only seen in him, but it's lived out through him and taught to disciples to be like him. We pray that we would be Talmidim Yeshua as we also become Talmidim Moshe and study the Torah today. We pray that on this Shabbat, you would become Adon HaShabbat, the Lord of the Sabbath, and we would rest in you today, Father, and we pray that your rest would be in us and upon us as we minister that sweet rest and peace to others. We pray that the peace of the Sabbath would give us peace from the Prince of Peace today. In Yeshua's name we pray, B'Shem Yeshua. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, I'd like to ask if there's anyone who has experienced loss during this week or who is in remembrance of someone who they may have lost during this time of the year. Okay. Today's Kaddish will be the short Kaddish, since in this case, at least let's always take the time to always know and recognize that we are the creation of God, therefore we are the ones who worship Him. So at this time, the Kaddish.
Yikadah ve yikadash shame rabba el madi brachirute ve'amnich machute becha yechon u'yomechon u'chayinechon be'Yisrael ve'agala ve'agala u'bizman karib ve'imen ru'amein ve'ishme rabba mevorach Elamul me'olmaya, yiparach, yiparach, v'yishtabach, v'yipar v'yroman v'yinase, v'yithatar, v'yithale, v'yithalal, shmei dikuli shabrichu, Elemi kol birchata, eshirata, tushbechata, benechemata, dami rambama, imeru amin.
Glorified and sanctified be his great name in the world which he has created according to his will. May he cause the reign of his kingdom in your lifetime and in your days, and in the life of all the house of Israel, speedily, yes, soon. And let us all say,
Amen.
May his great name be blessed forever and forever eternally. Blessed and praised, glorified and exalted, extolled and honored, adored and lauded, be the name of the Holy One. Blessed be he who is high above, far above all blessings and hymns and praises and consolations which are spoken in the world. Let us all say,
Amen.
And at this time, let us unite our hearts together as we face the east and we give the blessing of the Shema.
Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shemo Malchuto Le'olam Vaeh.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God,
the Lord is one. Blessed be his glorious name, whose kingdom is forever and ever. Amen.
Ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha v'chol levavcha u'v'chol nafshecha u'v'chol me'avdecha ve'hayu hadevarim ha'ele asher anochi metzavecha hayom al levavcha ve'shinatam levavcha ve'divartam b'ham ve'shivtecha ve'beitecha u'v'atecha v'aderech u'v'shofecha u'kumecha ושרתם לאות הידיך, והיו לתותפות בעיניך, וכתבתם על מזוזות ביתך, ומשעריך.
אמן. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Let these words that I command you today be upon your heart. Teach them thoroughly to your children, and speak to them while you sit in your home, while you walk on the way, when you retire, and when you arise. Bind them as a sign upon your arm, and let them be frontlets between your eyes, and write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. Amen. Ve'ahavta le'racha kamocha, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Amen. And at this time, I shall be given the blessing of Ein Kamocha. There is none like you to begin our Torah service.
Ein kamocha ba'elohim, Adonai ein kemasecha, malchuticha, malchut kol olamim, u'memsheltecha bechol dor v'ador. Adonai melech, Adonai malach, Adonai yimloch le'olam va'ed. Adonai os le'amo yitein, Adonai yibarech et amo v'shalom. Av harachamim heitiva v'rtzoncha et zion, tibneh chomot Yerushalayim, ki becha levad batachnu. Melech El Ram Ben Issa, Adon Olamim.
There is none like you, O Lord, among the gods that are worshipped, and there are no deeds like yours. Your kingdom is forever. You reign through all generations. The Lord reigns. The Lord will reign forever and ever. O Lord, give strength to your people. O Lord, bless your people with peace. Father of compassion, deal kindly with Zion according to your will. Rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, for we trust in you alone, O King, revered and honored God, Master of the entire universe. Amen.
Vayehi b'mso Aharon, vayomer Moshe, kuma Adonai, ve'yachutzu oyvecha, ve'yanusu mesanecha mipanecha, ki mitzion tetze Torah. Imitzion tetze Torah udavar Adonai Yerushalayim Baruch Shenatan Torah Torah Baruch Shenatan
Israel, in Dushato.
And when the ark would travel, Moses would say, Arise, O Lord, and let your enemies be scattered, and let them flee from before your face. For from Zion will go forth the Torah, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem, blessed be he, who gave the Torah to his people Israel in his holiness. Amen. Baruch Hu Adonai HaMevorach.
Baruch Adonai
HaMevorach Le'olam Ba'ed.
Baruch Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Asher Bachar Banu Mikol Hamim Ve'natan Lanu Et Torato. Baruch Adonai Noten HaTorah. Amen.
Bless the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed is the Lord, the Blessed One, for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who chose us from all people and gave us the Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen. Boker Tov and Shabbat Shalom to y'all.
Boker Tov.
Shabbat Shalom. I'd like to ask if there's anyone who is here for the first time, who is for the first time here in this building, or who is with us for the very first time. No takers? Oh, well, we got a couple people right here. Hey, let's give them a warm welcome, okay? Well, you know what we actually like to give as a nice welcoming gift, if you will. We like to ask and offer, if you like to do what is called Aliyah, to come up to the reading table to see our Torah scroll, to see the Hebrew language, and you even get to see the name of God as well. And we like to take the opportunity to do that, as well as the students of the Hebrew class and the members of the congregation. If you'd like to come on up for today's portion, please do so now.
This is our way to also get to know you, too. So we'd like to just hear your first name, the city you're from. Temecula, wonderful.
Jeff,
wonderful. Great to have both of you with us. And I was just in Temecula last week and after Shabbat, so it was great, yeah. Become a friend on Facebook, you might see a few pictures. Well, we got a Torah scroll that's 125 years old. It has some trials and tribulations it's been through, but I love the fact that it's rolled right to the Shema, what we sang this morning, what Yeshua called the greatest commandment of all. Next to love your neighbor as yourself, right? And so right here we have, let's point to it, Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. So notice the enlarged letter, the third letter of the word Shema from here. It's interesting that the letter that's last is Ein, which is pictographically the picture of eyes. They kind of look like spectacles to me, you know, the old-fashioned spectacles. And so whether the eye of a fountain of water or the eye in the body that allows water to come out called tears, we have the eyes that even in hearing, there is seeing. So the idea is that here you have the letter Sheen, which the funny thing is Sheen are teeth. And then you have Mem, which is water. And then it's like hearing helps what comes out of the mouth be seen by being attentive to what you hear. So it's interesting when you have all those together, you see all the senses are involved. When someone's speaking or leading, we know that there also has to be eyes to see and ears to hear the deep things of God to be able to understand them. We also have the famous name for Jacob, which is spiritually Israel, not only to him as a spiritual name, Prince of God, he who strives with God, but it's also the nation that he became, right? Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Abraham was told, I'll make you a great nation. Actually, it's Abram. I'll make your name great to Abraham, and then I'll make you a great nation. So that's actually something we'll look at in our Torah portion today. And then the famous Tetragrammaton, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh. Notice the elongated hey. Whenever the scribes want to draw attention to something, they can enlarge a letter, or show humility, they can reduce a letter in size for teaching purposes. So we see the significance of God's name being specific. Now, I love the fact that the two heys in the name of God are given to Abraham and Abram and Sarai as covenant, because the letter that is the first hey goes to Abram to make Abraham, which makes his name from a father who's exalted to the father of multitude, and from the word hamon, meaning a multitude of people. Av hamon, hamon goyim, a father of a multitude of Gentiles or nations. And then you have the last hey for Sarai to become Sarah, the last hey in her name, turns it from a masculine form, my prince or leader, to my princess. It softens it. The kamatz hey in Hebrew makes the sound, or makes a feminine sound. Ah. So the concept of the two hays, you can see God revealed his covenant name to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but he also, and to Moses, but he also gave some of the letters of his name in covenant, because whenever you cut covenant, we know we take on the name. The son takes on the name of the father, but the wife takes on the name of the husband or the family name. And so we see this is kind of like we've been invited into God's family, right?
Amen.
And he is Elohim, or in this form, Eloheinu, nu from anachnu, meaning we or our. And so Eloheinu means our God. So we're saying that Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, which we say Adonai in respect, because we don't know how to pronounce all four letters of those names. Everything is a guesswork, even on the internet today. Except for the first two letters. We say Hallelujah.
Yah.
So sometimes Yah is all the way by itself. In fact, Hallelujah are two separate words. Hallelujah means praise him. Yah means, it's like Tom for Thomas, right? Will for William. It's the shortened form of God's name. In fact, Isaiah, Jeremiah, you hear Yah, or even the extra letter added, the Vav would be a U sound and be Yahu. Isaiah is pronouncing him Yeshe Yahu, Eliyahu, Elijah. So this is the tetragrammaton. We respectfully say Adonai, or in conversation we can say Hashem, just out of respect. I think it's a great concept. And then Eloheinu means is our God. So the is understood. So it's really Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, or Adonai is our God. And then it says the name again, Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, with the word Echad. And that would be understood with is, that Adonai is one. So the Lord is one. The Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Now, if we take the large letter here, Ein, and we take the Dalit, which means door. Or a picture of a door. We see eyes looking through a door, which is a witness. So witnesses, we're a congregation. Our eyes have looked through the door. We like what we see. We come in, we witness and testify of what we've seen. So edah is a congregation, or edot, witnesses, and or edut is a testimony. And so we see here all of these letters are significant, but if you put these two letters together in your eyesight, they spell witness. So when Jews die, they always say these words as witness. We're never going to deny the God who delivered us from Egypt. He's only one. He's not like the Egyptian gods, multiple. Okay. And then, of course, the Be'ahavta we have. We learned today about the Shiva Na, over the Shiva Nach, the resting Shiva, or the vocal Shiva. And right here, Nach Shecha, we have a Nun with a Patach underneath for Asam, Na. But we have a Shiva Nach here, which would be one Shiva, two dots underneath, will have a colon. That would be silent, so it's Nach. And then the next one's vocal, She, gives it a short E sound. And then the masculine singular ending, Cha, which would give it the pronominal suffix, your soul, Nach Shecha. So that's our lesson that we learned today. You should show the class if you like it. He's technically our only bar mitzvah in the house that we've been bar mitzvah other than myself. So we have a whole new crew of bar and bat mitzvahs, men and women of the commandment that are going to rise up in this congregation. So very good portion. Now, we haven't gotten to the portion yet. Which, aha, you found it. And the famous word, Ekev, like Yaakov in the text. If I were looking at that, I'd say, what's that heel doing there? That's the Hebrew word for heel, but it's translated a number of ways, referring to putting your heel down, or the end result of something, or because you did this, this is what's going to happen. And then there's the Shema again, Tish Mabun, referring to hearing or hearkening to or obeying. And so it's going to be very important to hear these words chanted. Our chazan, our cantor, will kiss the spot where he begins, and we'll hear the Torah.
והיה עקב תשמעו אל המשפטים האלה ושמעתם ועשיתם אותם ושמעת אדוני אלוהיך לך אל הברית ואל החסד אשר נשפע על אבותיך בהיבך וברכך והרבך וברך בבינך ופרי אדמתך דגנך בהירושך ביצחריך שגרבך בשדרות צונך על האדמה אשר נשבע לאותך לתת לך ברוך תהיה מכל העמים לא יהיה לך בקר בקרה ובבהמתך בישיר אדוני ממך כל חולים וכל מלפיהם מצרים הרעים אשר ידעתם לא ישימם פח ונתנם בכל צונך ואכלת את כל העמים אשר אדוני אלוהיך נותן לך לא תחוס עיניך עליהם ולא תעבור את אלוהיהם כי מוקש הוא לך
Okay, so that was, you had 10, what, 7 verses? Or, I'm looking at the letter, but not realizing it's didn't start with verse 1 today. All right, so we have 5 verses, very good, Tov Me'od. Just a little highlight there of the words.
So at least, and it will be that because you have heard, and you have heard my these rulings.
There's another way to look at this. The heel result of this. The end of the body, right? The heel,
yes.
The end result. Okay.
You have heard these rulings and you have kept them, shmartem, and you have done them, and you have the Lord will keep all of you, and the covenant habrit of grace that He swore unto your fathers. So lavotecha nishba lavotecha.
What was the covenant again?
The habrit, the covenant, and the grace that...
Actually, that's chesed,
chesed
mercy.
Mercy.
So that would either be mercy or loving kindness. Chen is grace or favor. So that's more properly translated as mercy, God's loving kindness.
So that He has sworn unto your fathers. Okay, so now one of the things that I looked at was the fact that in the term Ekev, it actually is the heel. And if you're walking this out, you're not supposed to just walk out the large commandments, the big deal commandments, even what may appear to be just commandments that we trample
small.
On all the time. So long and short,
well,
we
a
have,
small rock under the foot still hurts.
Yes.
Hurts more, actually.
Yes.
A so we don't want to, to ignore. Sometimes we worry about the big rocks, but we ignore the little rocks, and they hurt our heels. So walking out this commandment shows a lot about how we should have the enemy underneath our feet, serpents or scorpions underneath, the things that if we were to actually prepare our feet to walk, we would gird or shod our feet with the preparation of the gospel. Guess what? The Torah is the preparation of the gospel. Because God revealed the gospel to Abraham ahead of time through the Torah. And by obeying, He kept him out of the trap that would lead to needing the gospel or salvation to fix your problem. So Torah actually gives you the pathway. When we walk off the pathway, we know we sin and we need a Savior to get back on the path. So the Torah can't save, but it leads you in the path to the Messiah, because He's never going to be on the path that leads to destruction.
The goal of
the Torah is Messiah, always. But it also shows the clear direction of what's right and what's wrong, what's the right path, what's the wrong path.
Amen.
Good job.
Just one last thing as well. This also is a place of where you find all the blessings that God gives if we keep these words. I as the more I heard about them, the more I went through this, I realized there are people who like to say, if you give $1,000, you know what? I'm sorry. This is where the blessing happens, not what comes out of the mouth. Obedience to these words.
Yeah, I like the way the Chumash version, the Arts Group version, actually translates Ekev reward. Because He's saying that in every step you take, there's a reward for your obedience.
Yeah.
Well, now I feel it's starting to heat up in here, right? Pray for our air to be fixed in about a week, I think, or so. We will get the air fixed. May the blessing of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob be on both of you for coming
Thank
and
you
joining.
So
and oh, wait, did we have an extra visitor that came up?
Yeah.
I didn't see that. Your name was again?
Ken.
Oh, in Hebrew, that's yes.
Yes.
So you'll be our yes man. Yes to God and no to ungodliness, right? That's beautiful. Welcome, welcome. And so at this time we're going to have our 5 readers read from the Torah portion. We'll have a 6th reader for the prophet reading, which will be myself. And then after the Hadashah reading, one of the ladies of our congregation will come and read the seventh reading for the Shabbat.
Boker Tov.
Boker Tov.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
And Sal, buongiorno.
Buongiorno. Hey, what about me?
And Rabbi.
Yeah.
Buongiorno.
Buongiorno.
Okay, so Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 12. Because you are listening to these rulings, keeping and obeying them, Adonai, your God, will keep with you the covenant and mercy that he swore to your ancestors. He will love you, bless you, and increase your numbers. He will also bless the fruit of your body and the fruit of your ground, your grain, wine, olive oil, and the young of your cattle and sheep, in the land he swore to your ancestors that he would give you. You will be blessed more than all other peoples. There will not be a sterile male or female among you. And the same with your livestock. Adonai will remove all illness from you. He will not afflict you with any of Egypt's dreadful diseases which you have known. Instead, he will lay them on those who hate you. You are to devour all the peoples that Adonai your God hands over to you. Show them no pity, and do not serve their gods, because that will become a trap for you. If you think to yourselves, these nations outnumber us, how can we dispossess them? Nevertheless, you are not to be afraid of them. You are to remember well what Adonai your God did to Pharaoh and all of Egypt, the great ordeals which you yourself saw, and the signs and wonders, strong hand and outstretched arm, by which Adonai your God brought you out. Adonai will do the same to all the peoples of whom you are afraid.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Deuteronomy 7:20-26. Moreover, Adonai your God will send the hornet among them until those who are left and those who hide themselves perish ahead of you. You are not to be frightened of them, because Adonai your God is there with you, a God great and fearsome. Adonai your God will expel those nations ahead of you little by little. You can't put an end to them all at once, or the wild animals become too numerous for you. Nevertheless, Adonai your God will give them over to you, sending one disaster after another upon them until they have been destroyed. He will hand their kings over to you, and you will wipe them out, their name from under heaven. None of them will be able to stand against you until you have destroyed them. You are to burn up completely the carved statues of their gods. Don't be greedy for the silver or gold on them. Don't take it with you, or you will be trapped by it, for it is abhorrent to Adonai your God. Don't bring something abhorrent into your house, or you will share it in the curse that is on it. Instead, you are to test it completely, loathe it utterly, for it is set apart for destruction.
Continuing in Deuteronomy 8:1-10. All the mitzvot I am giving you today, you are to take care to obey, so that you will live, increasing your numbers, enter and take possession of the land Adonai swore about to your ancestors. You are to remember everything of the way in which Adonai led you these 40 years in the desert, humbling and testing you in order to know what was in your heart, whether you would obey his mitzvot or not. He humbled you, allowing you to become hungry, and then fed you with man, which neither you nor your ancestors had ever known, to make you understand that a person does not live on food alone, but on everything that comes from the mouth of Adonai. During these 40 years, the clothing you were wearing didn't grow old, and your feet didn't swell up. Think deeply about it. Adonai was disciplining you just as a man disciplines his child. So obey the mitzvot of Adonai, your God, living as he directs and fearing him. For Adonai, your God, is bringing you into a good land, a land with streams, springs of water, welling up from the depths and the valleys and the hillside. It's
it's a land of wheat and honey, barley, grapevines, fig trees, and pomegranates, a land of olive oil and honey, a land where you will eat food in abundance and lack nothing in it, a land where the stone curb contain iron and the hills can be mined for copper. So you will eat and be satisfied, and you will bless Adonai your God for the good land he has given you.
Continuing in Deuteronomy chapter 10, verses 12 through 21. So now, Israel, all that Adonai your God asks from you is to fear Adonai your God, follow all his ways, love him, and serve Adonai your God with all your heart and all your being, to obey for your own good the mitzvot and regulations of Adonai, which I am giving you today. See, the sky, the heaven beyond the sky, the earth and everything on it, all belong to Adonai your God. Only Adonai took enough pleasure in your ancestors to love them and choose their descendants after them, yourselves, above all peoples, as he still does today. Therefore, circumcise your foreskin of your heart, and don't be stiff-necked any longer. For Adonai your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great, mighty, and awesome God, who has no favorites and accepts no bribes. He secures justice for the orphan and the widow. He loves the foreigner, giving him food and clothing. Therefore, you are to love the foreigner, since you were foreigners in the land of Egypt. You are to fear Adonai your God, serve him, cling to him, and swear by his name. He is your praise, and he is your God, who has done for you these great and awesome things, which you have seen with your own eyes. Your ancestors went down into Egypt with only 70 people, and now Adonai your God has made your numbers as many as the stars in the sky.
Deuteronomy 11, verses 1 through 9. Therefore, you are to love Adonai your God, and always obey his commissions, regulations, rulings, and mitzvot. Today, it is you I am addressing, not your children, who haven't known or experienced the discipline of Adonai your God, his greatness, his strong hand, his outstretched arm, his signs and his actions which he did in Egypt to Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and to his entire country. They didn't experience what he did to Egypt's army, horses, and chariots, how Adonai overwhelmed them with the water of the Sea of Suf, as they were pursuing you, so that they remain destroyed to this day. They didn't experience what he kept doing for you in the desert until you arrived at this place, or what he did to Datan, Abiram, the sons of Eliab, the descendants of Reuben, how the earth opened its mouth and swallowed them up along with their households, tents, and everything in their company, there in front of all Israel. But you have seen with your own eyes all these great deeds of Adonai. Therefore, you are to keep every mitzvot I am giving you today, so that you will be strong enough to go on in and take possession of the land that you are crossing over to conquer, and so that you will live long in the land Adonai swore to give your ancestors and their descendants, a land flowing with milk and honey. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. You know, much of this teaching on Ekev, the heel result of our actions, really teaches a lot about consequences. And it's amazing when we think about how the manna came down to teach us whether we were going to obey him or not. You know, whether we were going to gather more than we needed per day, or we were going to choose not to gather at all one day. And that consistency of having our morning manna every day. How many feel like your morning manna spiritually is so important, even with the devotional that we go through each week? How many have been enjoying that morning manna? And the more we do it as a congregation, the more we're ready for Shabbat, like an army that's had all the same instructions from our commander. I think it's so important for us to follow in the ways of God together, not everybody doing their own thing, because what happens is when we all get our own little revelation, that's where sometimes false doctrines come in, and that's where people start wanting to break off and start their own ministries. Why can't we do ministry within the congregation instead of always trying to create entities and identities that are outside of the local body of believers? I think it should be underneath the covering of a household. And when Moses wanted them to follow the commandments, he knew how easy it was for people like sheep to wander off. And it's much harder when the shepherd has to go break a bunch of legs, right? And bring you back, and then he's got to mend you. And think about all the sheep that had to be mended. Sadly enough, when the wolf comes, if you wander off too much, sometimes the shepherd can't get to you fast enough. And how many people in the wilderness actually were eaten by the wolf, if you will, or bit by the snake, or swallowed by the earth, or plagued with leprosy? Guess what? None of us want those consequences. But they're really consequences of our action. I think what the Torah is trying to teach us is, for every action, there is a result to that action. There's even a reaction sometimes to action. And I think we should not blame God or blame our circumstances, but we should look in the mirror of Torah and see ourselves and say, what am I doing that keeps giving me the same results? Because I'm expecting different results from the same action or reaction. Guess what? That's insanity. It's the definition of insanity. But when we look into the perfect law of liberty and see who we are now and see who we could be like, Messiah, and be conformed to the image of the Son, all of a sudden the Torah has a point of view that leads to see Messiah better, hear His voice, follow His commands, and especially walk in His footsteps.
Amen.
That's what Ekev is all about.
Amen.
So let's say the blessing for the closing of the reading of the Torah today. Together.
Baruch ata Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher natan lanu Torah temet, v'chai olam ata betochenu. Baruch ata Adonai, notein ha-Torah. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the Torah of truth and life everlasting, planted in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen. Hakba is the lifting of the Torah scroll, revealing three panels from the reading. We point to it as a witness, declaring this is the word of the Lord.
V'zot ha-Torah asher sam Moshe lifnei b'nei Yisrael al pi Adonai v'yad Moshe.
And this is the Torah that Moses placed before the children of Israel at the command of the Lord by the hand of Moses.
Amen.
Place upon the Torah again the belt of truth, the way we as an army should wear the belt of truth. Amen?
Amen.
We cover it with its mantle and breastplate, just as we should be covered and have the breastplate of righteousness over our lives today. Martin asked me, who's going to carry it? I said, you're going to carry it. Obviously, Eric was not able to make it this morning, so we're used to him doing it. But today we cover it with its breastplate. And we know the pointer always points to Yeshua the Messiah. Amen. So we're going to place the Etz Haim, the tree of life, back into the ark today. Let's sing.
Etz Haim hi lamacha tzikim ba v'tomche ha'mevusha v'ra'eha.
It is the tree of life for those who take hold of it, and those who supported our praise with its ways and ways of pleasantness, and all its paths are peace. Bring us back, O Lord, to you, and we shall come renew our days as of old. Amen. I just had a revelation. As I'm looking at the Messianic Jerusalem seal, and I'm seeing the Tree of Life as we're singing Etz Haim, the Tree of Life, and I'm thinking about how Israel, the nation, is to also bring a Torah to the nations as a light to the nation and be fishers of men. through Yeshua the Messiah, I thought about the veil of the Holy of Holies, and I thought about the two cherubim that were guarding the tree of life, or entrance back into the garden. Technically, Torah gives us access back to God's garden. It takes us back to Genesis. It takes us back to the ways of the Lord. And as we were standing here, I was thinking that we were guardians of the entrance, the way to the truth and the life. The way, Torah is the Torah of truth, and it gets us to the life of Yeshua. Amen. And when it's Etz Hayim, it's a tree of life, because Yeshua died on a tree. And that tree, through his life, he gave us life. Amen.
Amen.
Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah.
So today we will hear the prophet reading. Let's say the blessing together. It will be found for Ekev in Isaiah 49:14-51:3, which is now the third Shabbat that we read from the book of Isaiah since Tisha B'Av. And this is a Shabbat that deals with Zion, and it deals with the result of Israel's actions and what the prophet was speaking. So it's interesting, the last couple of weeks we had Shabbat of the vision, Shabbat Chazon, and we had Shabbat of comfort, Shabbat Nachamu. And so let's see what the prophet has to tell us this week as he speaks to Zion.
Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Asher bachar yedinim tovim Beratzavi divrehem hanemarim beemet Baruch ata Adonai Habocher batorah v'mishay abdo Yisrael amo Yidgei haemet batzedek Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen the prophets and was pleased with their words that were uttered with truth. Blessed are you, O Lord, who chooses the Torah, Moses his servant, Israel his nation, and the prophets of truth and righteousness. Amen. Today the prophet Isaiah, Yeshayahu, chapter 49, verse 14, says in the Arts of Humash, and Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me. My Lord has forgotten me. Can a woman forget her nursling? Withdraw from feeling compassion for the child of her womb? Even where these two forget, yet I will not forget. Behold, I have engraven you upon my palms of my hand. Your ruined walls are before me continuously. Your children shall hasten to repent, and your spoilers and your destroyers must depart from you. Raise your eyes about you and see all of them assemble. They come to you. I swear as I live, the word of the Lord, that you shall clothe yourself with them all as with jewelry and adorn yourself as with them as a bride. For your ruins and your desolations and your spoiled land shall now become cramped with inhabitants, and those who would swallow you up shall be at a far distance. The children of your bereavement shall yet say in your ears, the place is tight for me, make room for me that I may sit. Then you will say in your heart, who has begotten me these? For I have been bereaved of children and alone, exiled and wandering, Israel said. And who has reared these new children coming into the kingdom? Behold, I was left by myself. These, where have they been? For thus says the Lord, Adonai Elohim, behold, I will raise my hand toward the nations, and to the peoples will I hoist my banner, and they shall bring your sons in their arms, and your daughters shall be carried on their shoulder. Kings will be your nurturers, and their princesses your nurses. With faces to the ground they will prostrate themselves to you. The dust of your feet will they lick. And you shall know that I am the Lord, that those who hope to me shall not be ashamed. You ask, can prey be taken back from a strong one? Can the righteous captive escape? But thus said the Lord, even the captive of the strong can be taken back, and the prey of the mighty can escape. I myself will take up your cause, and I myself will save your children, and I will feed your oppressors their own flesh, and as the sweet wine shall they become drunk, and then all flesh shall know that I am the Lord, your Savior, your Redeemer, and the Mighty One of Israel.
Chapter 50, verse 1. Thus says the Lord, where is your mother's divorce document with which I sent her away? Speaking of northern Israel. Or which of my creditors is it to whom I have sold you? Behold, it is for your iniquities that you have been sold. Meaning it's your consequences, it's your sins, your actions. And for your rebellious transgressions that your mother has been sent away. Why is it that although I have come, there is no man? Why is it that although I have called, there is no answer? Is my hand too very short for redemption? Is there no strength in me to rescue? Behold, by my rebuke I dry up the sea. I set rivers as a desert. Their life fish putrefies for lack of water, and it dies for thirst. I clothe the heavens in black and make sackcloth their garment. O my Lord, Adonai Elohim, has given me a tongue for students to know, to set a time for one thirsty for the word of the Lord. And he arouses me every morning, he arouses my ear for me to hear like the students. My Lord Adonai Elohim has opened my ear for me, and for me I did not rebel, I did not turn away backwards. My body I gave to the smiters, and my cheeks to the pluckers, and my face I did not hide from humiliations and spit. Sounds like Messiah. For my Lord Adonai Elohim helps me, therefore I was not humiliated. Therefore I set my face like flint, and I knew that I would not be ashamed. My champion is near, whosoever would contend with me. Let us stand together. Let whosoever is my plaintiff approach me. Behold, my Lord Adonai Elohim shall help me. Who will condemn me? Behold, they shall all become worn out like a garment, and a moth shall devour them. Who among you fears Adonai, listening to the voice of his servant? Though he may have walked in darkness with no light for himself, let him trust in the name of the Lord and lean upon his God. Behold, all of you others are igniters of fire, girdled with fireworks. So away in the flame of your fire and in the fireworks have you kindled. From my hand has this come upon you, that you should lie down in sorrow. The latter part is chapter 51, verse 1 says, listen to me, O pursuers of righteousness. Seekers of Adonai, look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the hollow pit from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your forefather, and to Sarah who bore you. For when he was yet one alone, did I summon him and bless him and make him many, make him great, the text says. For Adonai shall comfort Zion. There's the talk to Zion. I will comfort Zion. He shall comfort all her ruins, and he shall make her wilderness like Eden. Talking about going back to the Garden of Eden. And her wasteland like a garden of Adonai. Joy and gladness shall be found there, thanksgiving and the sound of music. Oh, do you think they got the movie from that? So we're thankful today that God can turn our wilderness back into the Garden of Eden. Amen? How many know we feel like we're in exile, but God can bring us back into our own land? How many know if God did it for Israel, God can do it for all nations to come one day to the New Jerusalem and learn the Torah and learn from the kings and priests that rule and reign for Messiah, you and I. We will be teaching Torah for a millennium. Man, can you imagine? That's going to be some long-winded classes, huh? But today, let's stand for the final blessing of the Torah today, and or for the prophet reading, and let's thank God that he gave us not only Moses the prophet, but he also gave us the prophets, the major and the minor prophets, that speak to our heart like Isaiah. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam sur kol haolamim tzadik b'chol ha'arot ha'el ha'neiman ha'omer ve'osei amdaber u'mkayein shechol devarav emet v'tzedek ne'amata hu Adonai Eloheinu v'nemerim devarecha v'devar echad mitvarecha achor lo yishirekam ki ha'melech ne'eman v'rakaman atah Baruch atah Adonai ha'el ha'neiman b'chol devarav. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, Rock of all eternities, righteous in all generations, the trustworthy God, who says and does, who speaks and fulfills, all of whose words are true and righteous. Trustworthy are you, O Lord our God, and trustworthy are your words. Not one of your words is turned back to its origin unfulfilled. For you are God, trustworthy and compassionate King. Blessed are you, O Lord, the God who is trustworthy in all his words. Amen. Have mercy on Zion, for it's the source of our life. To the one who is deeply humbled, bring salvation speedily in our days. Blessed are you, O Lord, who gladden Zion through her children. Amen. Gladden us, O Lord our God, with Elijah the prophet, your servant, and with the kingdom of the house of David, your anointed Messiah. May he come speedily and cause our heart to exult. On his throne, let no stranger sit, nor let others continue to inherit his honor. For by his holy name you swore to him that his lamp will not be extinguished forever and ever. Blessed are you, O Lord, shield of David, Magen David. Amen. Al ha-Torah, al ha-Avodah, al ha-Nevi'im, al yom ha-Shabbat hazeh, shenatata lanu Adonai Eloheinu, likdusha v'limnocha, lechavod v'letifaret. Al ha-Kol Adonai Eloheinu, anachnu modim lach, u'rachim otach, Yitbarach Shemcha befiko hai, temi leolam vayet, Baruch ata Adonai, Kadesh HaShabbat. Amen. For the Torah reading, for the prayer service, for the reading from the prophets, and for this Sabbath day that you, O Lord our God, have given us, for holiness and contentment, for glory and splendor, for all this, O Lord our God, we gratefully thank you and bless you. May the name Your name be blessed by the mouth of all of the living ones for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord, who sanctifies the Sabbath. Amen.
As the brief Parashat reader comes at this time, we'll have our final blessing and reading from the New Covenant. Ahava.
Tova.
Tova.
Beseder.
Beseder. We'll be learning about Ahava today in the Torah portion.
Shabbat Shalom, Havarim.
Let's say the blessing together.
Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Natan Lanu Mashiach Yeshua Ve'Hadevarim Shel HaBrit HaChadasha. Baruch Ata Adonai Notein HaBrit HaChadasha. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us Messiah Yeshua and the words of the new covenant. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen.
This reading is from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 31 through 39. A letter from Yeshua's emissary, Rabbi Shaul, Paul, to the Messianic community in Rome. What then are we to say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare even his own son, but gave him up on behalf of us all, is it possible that having given us his son, he would not give us everything else too? So who will bring a charge against God's chosen people? Certainly not God. He is the one who causes them to be considered righteous. Who punishes them? Certainly not the Messiah Yeshua, who died, and more than that, has been raised. Is at the right hand of God and is actually pleading on our behalf. Who will separate us from the love of the Messiah? Trouble, hardship, persecution, hunger, poverty, danger, war. As the Tanakh puts it, for your sake, we are being put to death all day long. We are considered sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are super conquerors, though the one who has loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor our heavenly rulers, neither what exists nor what is coming, neither powers above nor powers below, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which comes to us through the Messiah Yeshua, our Lord.
Amen. You know, I love the fact that Rav Shaul seemed to be drawing from the prophet reading. Can I Can I give you the summation of what was said? In chapter 50 of Isaiah, the word that I read, and I almost made a comment about it earlier, it said in verse 7 of Isaiah 50, "For my Lord Adonai Elohim helps me. Therefore I was not humiliated. Therefore I set my face like flint." And it said, "And I knew that I would not be ashamed. My champion is near. Whosoever shall contend with me." Who shall contend with me? "Let us stand together. Let whosoever is my plaintiff approach me." And if you think about who should contend with me, it's almost like a lawyer. And when it says the plaintiff, as a good doctor of the Torah, this Pharisee or rabbi, a doctor of the law, is actually saying, who can come against us? Who's going to bring an accusation against his people? If God no longer allows Israel to be in exile and he brings them out, then they're not in prison any longer. They're brought out back into their own land as free. Who's going to try to put them back into bondage? No one. Who is their accuser? No one. Who's going to condense against them? No one. Who's going to separate them from the love of God? No one. That's what Rav Shaul was drawing from. And when I read that, I thought, wow, that's exactly the language of that dialogue. Today, we can rest in the fact that Yeshua, the Messiah, has made sure as our attorney, our advocate, our lawyer, our standby, our comforter. He said, "I'll give you another comforter, but I've been your comforter all this time, teaching you to how to deal with the accuser of the brethren." Amen. Amen. So today, we can rest in the fact that we've been forgiven. Amen. We've been freed from the crimes. Amen. Amen. Let's thank God for this meeting today as we say the final blessing.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam
asher natalanu divrei emet b'chayei olam natah betochenu
Baruch atah Adonai noteinu b'rivcha shah. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who gave us the words of truth and life everlasting planted in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the new covenant. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Shabbat shalom, everyone.
Shalom.
Going to be in the house of the Lord today?
Amen.
Yes. You give God a praise like he's worthy. Say, praise him. I know it's been a warm summer, but God always cools us down with the cool breeze of the Holy Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
Some of you might know that when God walked with Adam in the cool of the day, it was literally in the ruach of the day, the spirit of the day. The spirit of God in Hebrew, ruach, actually can be breath or wind. But in this case, I believe it was the Holy Spirit that was walking with Adam. I think that's how he knew God was speaking to him, because his sheep hear his voice. Amen?
Amen.
And so today we are going to look at a message out of Parashat Ekev, Footsteps of Messiah. How many want to hear those footsteps?
Amen.
As it gets closer and closer. So today we're going to look at the portion which starts in Devarim, or Deuteronomy 7:12 through 11:25 that we read today in our Torah portion. Yeshayahu, or Isaiah 49:14-51:3 is our prophet reading, known as the Haftarah. And then as Messianic believers, we read from the Brit Hadashah also, which is Romans 8:31-39, went perfectly with the prophet reading today. And then we want to say our hearty Baruchim Haba'im, a welcome to all of our first-time guests and returning family members. I see some wonderful faces that I miss, and good to see you this morning. Shabbat shalom to all of you. And I hope I get a chance to get a hug in there, or a handshake, or a time to fellowship with you today. So we are looking at 10 minutes of Torah. How many ready for our 10-10-10?
Yeah.
You've been enjoying that morning manna every day?
Yes.
All right, I got some new morning manna. I'm just going to give you a little disclaimer. I didn't remember to change the prayer focus and spiritual challenge for day 7, which is actually just the Shabbat of next week. That's okay, because we're going to review what we learned this week on the footsteps of Messiah leading to the Feast of Messiah. So I'm going to kind of tie in both of those concepts, because as we get closer to hearing the footsteps, how many know the footsteps need to eventually lead to a footstool? And we sit down at a Shabbat rest and at a feast day to eat a meal with Messiah. Amen?
Yeah.
So we're going to actually tie in both of those. So it's still a great prayer focus and spiritual challenge. Okay? So let's take a look at, in our 10 minutes of Torah, let's take a look at our Mosaic instruction found in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 12. And the name of our portion is the first word, because, or in Hebrew, Ekev. Can you say Ekev?
Ekev.
You are listening to these rulings. Because you are listening, literally, the Ekev is a heel in Hebrew, like Yaakov, hand on heel, Jacob, the heel catcher. But it can mean the heel or end result of something. How many know when you put your foot down, that's it. Put your foot down, one good time. Where should the enemy be? The enemy should be under your feet. What did Yeshua come to crush with his heel? The serpent's head, right? So we know first messianic prophecy is really Genesis 3:15, that the heel will crush the head. And so the seed of the woman will crush the head of the serpent with his heel. And Jacob, who was a heel catcher, was trying to protect the promise given in the womb of the older will serve the younger. So the concept of Ekev can refer to an end result of something, a reward after or result of or consequence of an action. So the heel is used in walking. And so without good strong heels, you can't plant your feet down and stand strong. You can't walk by faith. A lot that involves the heel refers to our spiritual walk in the Lord. And so the idea of walking with God is really starting to learn to listen to God. Because you know, when your children start walking, it's because they're listening to your instructions that they start walking out not only what you say, but what you do. Amen?
Amen.
So this word, Ekev, strangely enough translated because here in this verse, is a heel result of something, is from listening. Say listening.
Listening.
But listening leads to keeping. Keeping leads to obeying. And Adonai, your God, will keep you with the covenant of mercy that he swore to your ancestors. He will, listen to this, he will love you, I love that, bless you, and increase your numbers. So say, he will love me. He will bless me. He will increase me. I find these to be the end result or the heel result to listening and obeying God. If you keep his commandments, he will keep his covenant that those commandments are based upon. And in that covenant, he promises he will love you, bless you, and increase you. How many want that blessing in their life? Okay, so he goes on to say, he will also bless the fruit of your body, the fruit of your ground, grain, wine, olive oil, young cattle, sheep, and the land that he swore to your ancestors that he would give you. Now, the first word I asked you to look on your 6 days of morning manna last week was the term listen. Say listen.
Listen.
I looked up listen, and in the Hebrew it can be translated a couple of different ways. We know the term shema means to hear, and this is tishma'un from that root shema, which means to hear, but it really comes from three different things: to hear, to pay attention, and to obey. Yes. So if you ask your child, did you hear me, you want to know, did they obey you, right? Did you hear me? Well, you said clean up the room. You are looking for results of that listening process. If they really heard you, they're going to heed what you said. So heard and heed and hearken to are all terms of the ear. And so to hear is to pay attention. Pay attention means you're paying attention so that you could obey. Great proverbs to read from Solomon are Proverbs 5, 7 through 12, 7, 24, and 8, 32. All talk about a son listening to the commands of his father. And I believe Solomon was rehearsing what David taught him, because David said, oh, how I love your Torah. Amen? Amen. Yeah. So the commandments that he would have taught Solomon was from the Torah. So let's look at the promise or result, the heel result of our listening. Number one, he says, he will love you. And I believe in response, he will love you as you love him.
Amen.
And this is what we call adoration. Or we adore God. If you really love him with all your heart, soul, and strength, that means you adore him. If I say I adore my wife, I just don't love her outward beauty. I love the way she thinks. I love even her emotions she shares with me. I love her heart. I love everything about her, and that makes me want to give my heart, show my feelings, and show her my mind's thoughts and goals for the future, and also share with her my physical life. In fact, my love to even embrace her, hold her, hug her, kiss her, all those forms of levels of intimacy and tokens of affection show that we love in a sense of adoring the person. How many know when you lift your hands in worship, you're reaching out for a hug? Amen. It's a form of intimacy in worship. Amen. When you pray, it's like holding the hand of God. You might be holding your hand to start, but eventually you'll be holding His. Right? When you talk to God, you're asking God to talk right back to you. You talk in prayer, He talks back through His Word, because His Word is eternal. Therefore, He's always talking. I love that. What God has said is what He's saying and what He will say. He doesn't change His mind. And so we see that He will love you as you love Him. I love what it says in Exodus, which is the book of Shemot, chapter 20, verse 6, from the commandments of God, actually presetting the, or setting the commandments in action. It says, but showing mercy to thousands, to those who love me and what?
Keep my
commandments. So notice loving God infers that you keep His commands. And Yeshua said the same thing in Yohanan or John 14:15. If you love me, keep my commandments. So if He came to do the will of the Father, then He must be talking about the Father's commandments, which is why He rehearses those commandments. Not to murder, not to steal, not to covet, right? And He definitely kept Shabbat, because we see it was His custom. So all of these things Yeshua did from His childhood. A young, rich young ruler said the same. Well, I've been doing these commands from my childhood. He said, well, you need to go one step further, because you're a rich man, and it's not a problem of you having riches. It's the problem of riches having you. So if you let go a part of your heart of those riches you hold on to, maybe you can actually allow more of God in your heart and give Him more of your heart. If you can let go of the riches, and maybe you can do another commandment called tzedakah. Righteously giving to the need at the moment. Why do we give? It's a righteous act. Why is it righteousness? It's the right thing to do. I see a poor person, it's wrong of me to not feed them, clothe them, take care of them. If someone's hurting and they're crying, it's wrong of me to walk by and say, oh, well, I don't know what they're crying about again. Oh, well. It's wrong. I should at least see what how they're doing. If someone's falling on the ground, I should just walk by and, like, remember the story of the Samaritan, the Good Samaritan? Do we just walk on by? Do we walk on by when we see the person hurting? What if we're a Levite or a Cohen? We have a responsibility to make sure that person takes care of, but not someone, not even of his own race, took care of him. Yeshua will say there should be no barrier in love. Jews and Gentiles should love each other equally. Amen? Jews and Samaritans. Now, if we go a little further on that note and look at the second benefit or end result, the Ekev of our obedience and our listening to God, He said He will bless you. And we know the purpose is to be a blessing. We call this not just like the first adoration, but now this leads to benediction. This means a blessing. How many know when at the closing of the service we give a benediction, like the priest of Numbers 6, 24 through 26 would give, to bless the people and keep them in those blessings? So Deuteronomy 30:16 is a great command here, where it says, in that I command you to love the Lord your God, to walk in His ways, to keep His commandments and statutes. I love when He promises that you will multiply and the Lord your God will bless you. So notice multiply, which means make you great and bless you. Well, this is what He told Abram in Deuteronomy chapter 12, that should be verse 3. I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make you great, and you shall be a what?
A blessing.
A blessing. Number 3 is the finality of that, and this is multiplication. He will increase and multiply you to make you great. Proverbs 1:5 says, a wise man will hear and increase what?
Learning.
And a man of understanding will attain wise counsel. Well, David said it like this in Psalms 115:13. He will bless you, those who fear the Lord, both small and great. May the Lord give you increase more and more, and you and your children, may you be blessed by the Lord who made heaven and earth. Isn't that beautiful? If we will just listen, we'll have more love, we'll have more blessings, we'll increase. Why? Because He says, I'll love you. I will bless you, and I will increase you. If He loves us, we love Him back. If He blesses us, we bless others. And if He increases us, that means He makes our name great, so He can showcase what He's doing in our life to do in someone else's life. Amen?
Amen.
Isn't that beautiful?
Yes.
How many ready for 10 minutes of the prophet reading, the Haftarah? Let's take a look at some prophetic precepts, starting with Isaiah 51 from our prophet reading. And it's verse 1 that says, listen to me. What did we focus on this week?
Listen.
That was day 1. He says, listen to me, and you who follow righteousness, you who seek the Lord. Look at this. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the hole of the pit from which you were dug. I love that. You know, when you dig for water down deep, you get a well. Well, Abraham dug a well, but the surrounding enemy wanted to plug up the well. So Isaac says, let's redig the well. So if you remember the well that's been dug, the fountain of life that's been dug for you, you don't let anybody plug up your well that's been dug. If you have to redig it, whatever the enemy's trying to cover up, you open it up. You dig for the water. Because I really believe that if we will look back at Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we will see a well of water that Moses could draw from, David could draw from, Solomon could draw from, and you and I as followers of Messiah, we could draw from. Because it's saying that Abraham is our father. What does he father us in? Faith. Faith that is part of the concept of faith is listening. Faith comes by what?
Hearing.
And hearing by the word of God. So, hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Look what it says. Look to Abraham, your father, and Sarah, who what?
Bore you.
So what does that make Sarah?
Mother.
Your mother. Commandment is honor your father and your mother. So if you notice, it says that he called him alone. He called him alone, meaning by himself. He had no children. But the Lord says he blessed him and increased him. So let's go back to the blessings again. Number one blessing of your Ekev, of listening, your end result of listening was, God said, I will what? I'll love you. That was the first one, adoration. The second was, I will bless you. That's benediction. And the third, I will increase you, which means Rabbah, make you great. So we have Shema, to hear. It leads to Avodah, Ahava, which is love. It leads also to blessing, which is bracha, blessing. And then it ends in rabbah, greatness. If you want to be great in the kingdom, what did Yeshua say? In Matthew 5:17 through 20, he says, you want to be great in the kingdom, do these commandments and teach others to do them. So you do and teach, do and teach, do and teach. Read Acts chapter 1, verse 1, do and teach. All that Yeshua began to do and teach. You can't be a rabbi unless you do them. And then you can teach them. Now, it's interesting because if you think about do and teach, the reverse also works. Yeshua said, if you break one of the least of these commandments, and you teach other people to break them, then you will be called least in the kingdom. How many would sign up to be least today? Let me see your hands. Good, very smart. How many want to be great in the kingdom and do great exploits for God? You're saying you all want to be rabbis then? No, not necessarily. The term rabbi is just a title we created into almost an office, but really it just meant whoever was the wisest, oldest elder of the community that could teach consistently the word of God as a master teacher, as a great teacher. You know, you tell kids they're great, but you also tell teachers they're great. Well, that's a great teacher. What'd you call him? I called him Rabbah. Or in Hebrew, Rabbi means my great master teacher. So what you're saying is, not only is he a great teacher, he's my teacher. Rabbi means my great teacher. But all it means is you personalize your learning. I know who from whom I'm learning from. And that's a concept we find in the New Covenant also. Now, if we go to Isaiah chapter 25, I feel like the rabbis there who sing the Torah, and sometimes they'll sing the term like that, like they're canting the reading. But in Isaiah 25, 16, it says, you have increased the what?
Nation.
Now, this is what is interesting. He says, look to Abraham. Remember, God picked him alone, and then God blessed him and increased him. Now I'm going to Isaiah 25, where he says, you've increased the nation. What did God promise Abraham? I will make you a great
nation.
But I'm also going to give you a great name. So individually, right? And then in your family, nationally, you're going to be great. You've increased the nation. Oh Lord, you have increased the nation. Boy, here's a double blessing. You've increased them. You are glorified. You have expanded all the borders of the land. Then why do we keep reducing them?
That's right.
Oh, let me leave that alone. Verse 16, I'm going to get political this morning. Lord, in trouble they visited you. You know what Israel's doing right now in the midst of trouble? They're visiting God. They're praying to God.
Yes.
Then in the midst of calamity, they're learning to cry out to God. And God is answering their cry. That's why 1948 happened. That's why 1967 happened. Can a nation be born in a day? Sure it can. So whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's that quick. It's that easy. And so he says, they visited you in trouble. They poured out a prayer when you were chastening them or disciplining them, or your chastening was upon them, it says. Now, if you look at verse 17, we'll see how that chastening happened. It says, as a woman with what?
Child
in pain, and cries out in her what?
Pains.
When she drew near the time of delivery, it says, so have we been in your sight, O Lord. We have been with child as a nation. We have been in pain. We have, as it were, brought forth wind. We have not accomplished any deliverance or salvation in the earth, nor have the inhabitants of the world fallen. So what he's saying is the Messiah hasn't come yet. Because who is salvation? Yeshua, Messiah. So the final ge'ulah or redemption, the final deliverance happens when the Messiah comes. You follow me? So all of Orthodox Judaism right now is looking for the coming of Messiah. Some even think they know who he is, that he needs to resurrect.
Amen.
The Babacher Rebbe, Menachem Mendel Schneerson, they believe he was, since he was from the tribe of Judah, that he's from the lineage of David, he potentially could have resurrected. Well then, why can't you consider Yeshua? Who also is from the tribe of Judah, who's from the lineage of David, why can't he resurrect? In fact, he already did.
Amen.
The only question to the Orthodox Jews is, well, then why hasn't he come back and set up a kingdom? Why didn't he just resurrect and immediately take the throne? Now, don't think it's so funny, because it's a legitimate question. That's because God is something unique in Micah chapter 5, and I wish I had time to go there. I'll have to visit it next week. But the birth of Messiah in Micah 5, 2, is right after, followed with Micah 5:3, that says God will give them up until there's a travail. And what we're going to realize is that there was a giving up of Israel as a nation to rule from until the nation travailed again. And when Israel began to travail, they were born in a day in 1948, and ever since, we've been in the days of the soon coming of Messiah. In fact, since 1967, 2017 will be a jubilee.
Yep.
So after the blood moon, the fourth one, get ready for some interesting stuff to start happening politically in the world, and for things to start happening quickly and rapidly on the ushering in of the Messianic age. Trust me, keep your head up, keep your eyes open. There's a lot going on in the world right now. I need to move on because I got to wrap this up. So Samach Tzedek, a great Rebbe of Chabad, speaking of Lubavitcher Rebbe, the third Chabad Rebbe, his name was Samach, which means the branch, Tzedek meaning righteous. He was called the righteous branch because even some considered him the Messiah, because the Messiah is called the branch. Okay, but it says that Samach Tzedek sees it as a reference to Ikvot Meshichah, the generation of the heels of Mashiach. The last generation of the exile is called the heels of Mashiach by our sages because, A, they are spiritually the lowest generation due to the descent of generations. Do you remember what Yeshua said? That the last generation would be like Sodom and Gomorrah? Look around. Check your politics. Check your society and culture. Check what is teaching our children in the schools. Check out what they're teaching your students. This is the spiritually lowest generation and most biblically illiterate generation. It used to be a Harvard grad, you had to preach a sermon in Hebrew.
Right.
Not just Greek. Hebrew was the language of scholarship. In America, what happened to Harvard? Secular. Completely secular. We don't see great evangelists coming out of Harvard anymore. Now, look at the second thing. B, it is the generation in which the footsteps of Mashiach can be already heard. Okay. So, it can be already be heard. This is the generation that will hearken, listen to the laws, the Torah. As Maimonides writes, this is the Sephardic Jew, the Rambam, the Torah has already promised that the people of Israel will return to Hashem at the end of their exile and will be immediately redeemed. So Chabad says this in their commentary,
The troubles and agony of what's called Hevli Mashiach, birth pains of Mashiach, however, are not unavoidable. What is man to do to be spared from the pangs of Mashiach? So the word Hevli or Hevle is Hevle Mashiach, means the birth pangs of Mashiach. How funny that Matthew 24 speaks of this. The birth pains of Mashiach, they said, how do you avoid these? You can't. He says, the only thing you can do is let him engage in Torah and act and acts of loving kindness. Chesed. Mercy. Remember the prophet reading? The word chesed? Okay. So, or even in the Torah portion. So, we see that it goes on to say, moreover, these are also good and happy signs. Say signs. Indicating the imminent coming of Mashiach. A good measure of prosperity, according to Sanhedrin 97a in the Talmud. A renewal of Torah study will be one thing that will bring the Messiah. How many know all over the world, even Christian churches, are hungering for more of Torah? Amen. Pastors are getting connected to rabbis. Yeah. Believers are realizing that they need to be taught like students of Jerusalem that learn the Torah, prophets, the writings. Second of all, opening of the gates of wisdom and the wellsprings of wisdom below. The gates of wisdom above and below. Remember the waters separate above and below? So he says two levels of wisdom need to be flowing through the hidden revelation found in the teachings of Torah. So this is where we go into the Peshat, beyond the Peshat level, past the Remez, and going into the Drash so that we can get the Sod, the different levels of interpretation down to the spiritual metaphor of the Torah, just like we learned that the Torah as milk feeds babies, but you can't grow without milk. And actually, as adults, you still drink milk to have strong bones, right? Good source of calcium. You can't have cheesecake without it. Yeah. And also in the time of Mashiach will awaken, many signs and miracles will occur in the world. So the rabbis say that when Messiah comes, there should be signs and wonders to usher in his coming. Well, so was the first coming Messiah. First coming Messiah brought signs and wonders. That's how they knew he was the Messiah. But because he didn't take up the rightful throne, they said, could he be the right Messiah? Maybe he's the one that suffers like Joseph, not the one that rules and reigns like David. Okay? I mean, ready for 10 minutes of read out of Shah? Did you get some out of that prophet reading? So the birth pains of Messiah and the footsteps of Messiah, according to the rabbis, are one and the same. To hear the footsteps of Messiah is like to feel the birth pains of Messiah. As we see him coming closer, we feel the birth of a new messianic age. It's amazing to me. So let's look at 10 minutes of the apostolic writings, starting with Matthew 24:5. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the what?
Messiah.
So the concept that is brought up here is, who is the Messiah? According to Yeshua, he says, many are going to come in my name saying they're the Messiah. How funny, I just mentioned someone who said he was the Messiah. Well, actually, he never said he was the Messiah. His students later called him the Messiah. Or they said potentially he could be if he resurrects. Why can't we do the same with Yeshua? Well, he's the Messiah. Well, no, he can't because he died. But what if he resurrects? Or better yet, what if he did resurrect? Then he is the Messiah. Because signs and wonders are supposed to follow him. And so they follow his believers. So he says, and they'll lead many astray. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. You will hear what? You will hear of them. You will hear of them. Shema. Listen. Hear. Be alert. See. Wait a minute. Hear. Now see. Did you hear that? Did you hear it? Did you see it? Ears are open. Eyes are open. You hear the wars. You see. And it says, see that you are not alarmed. So even though you see it, don't be alarmed at what you see. For this must happen, but it is not yet the end. It's not the Ekev yet. Until the heel of Messiah touches down on the Mount of Olives. Did you catch that? The heel of Messiah has to touch down on the Mount of Olives. Verse 7, for nation will rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. But all these things are the beginning of birth pains, which are birth pains. Because birth pains have two dimensions, frequency and intensity. As they hit quicker, they hit harder. So frequency is how often do they come, and intensity, how hard do they hit. You notice increase of earthquakes and hurricanes and diseases and pestilence and violence and war and rumors of war. Just look at the news. You see, we've always had earthquakes, we've always had pestilence, but now they're hitting quicker and they're hitting harder. It is true. Now, let's go to another passage that deals with these birth pains. 1 Thessalonians 5:1 says, but you have no need to have anything written to you, brothers, about the times and dates, the times and the seasons, the Moedim, the feast days. We'll reintroduce this next week when we talk about the feast days being a sign of the coming of the Messiah. So he says, when this will happen, because you yourselves well know that the day of the Lord will come like a what?
In
the night. And when people are saying, everything is so peaceful, medical care is free, is everywhere. Our politics are great. Our leadership is great. When everything looks on the outside, which is usually fluff, to be politically peaceful, because everybody's agreeing with the secular voice of political correctness. All of a sudden, what will happen is, they'll think everything's peaceful and secure, then destruction will suddenly come upon them the way labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will escape. What did the rabbi say? The birth pains of Messiah, can you avoid them? Absolutely not. The only thing you can do is just literally hold on to the Torah, begin to show and express the Torah in ways that follow in the footsteps of our patriarchs, which also now lead to following the footsteps of Messiah, because that's what he taught us to do. Let me prove this to you. If you just go down a few verses in the same passage, I'm going to show you that the same instruction that the rabbis gave us to embrace and engage in Torah, to follow in ways of loving kindness and chesed as the days get worse, that as it gets dark in this world, we need to shine bright. That we don't curse the darkness, but we shine the light. Amen? Amen. Shine the light of Messiah. That we don't need to blast people on Facebook. In fact, we need to have our face more in the book than have our face on Facebook. Because if you don't want to face the stuff you put on Facebook, don't put stuff that you don't want people to comment negatively about. Because they're going to do it. So be very careful and cautious what you put on Facebook. Use your Facebook to shine the light of Messiah instead of always worrying about cursing the darkness. If you tell a person how wrong they are, they never learn how right they can be. You're wasting your teaching time on what they've done wrong instead of teaching like children what they can do right. Amen. This is how we do it. Okay? So if we just go down a few verses, it says in verse 15, see that no one repays what?
Evil
for evil. Wait a minute. This is on the heel of, did you catch that? This is on the heel of the birth pains of Messiah. So he should have been telling us, get some extra water and extra food and build a tunnel and, you know, create some kind of bomb shelter. Notice he didn't tell us to do that. Yeshua says, as the birth pains get closer, and as the night gets darker, and as you get darker, you're people of the light. Shine the light. How do you shine the light? Don't repay evil for evil. Someone else is chopping off heads, you don't chop off heads. Right? Someone blasts your religion, don't blast theirs. I know it's easy to do. Watch this. It says, always try to do good to each other, indeed to everyone. Verse 21, but do test everything. So we're not supposed to believe everything. So even though we don't curse the darkness, we don't believe the darkness. So the stuff we see politically going on in the world right now, you don't have to believe everything. You don't have to go in with it, fall in, okay, well, this is what's politically going on in the world. They voted this way. I'm just going to go along with it. I didn't tell you to go along with it. I just told you not to curse everybody out that's walking with that. Show them the way out to the light. But be careful how you do it. Do it in love. Because look what it says. It says, but do test everything. Hold on to what is good. What did the rabbis tell us? Hold on to the Torah. Show love and mercy. That's why Hasidic rabbis are known as pious rabbis, because the word Hasidic means that they're showing mercy. Chesed. That's what it's supposed to be about. I love what it says in verse 22. But keep away from every form of evil. May the God of Shalom make you completely holy. May your entire spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless for the coming of our Lord Yeshua the Messiah. So wait a minute. As we're getting closer to the Messiah, we see a blood moon. Do we live in fear?
No.
We walk in faith. As the world gets darker, do we curse the darkness?
No.
We shine the light, walk in the light. Do we leave Torah?
No.
No, we embrace Torah and hold on to Torah because the Torah shows us what is good and not what is evil to walk in. And so when we see this, if the Torah leads us to Messiah, then the Torah should sharpen our ear to hear His footsteps coming. And it should sharpen our sense to be able to feel the birth pains that we're experiencing. If you don't feel the thumps going on in our spiritual womb, then you don't realize what God is getting ready to bring to pass. Israel had not seen the delivery of the birth pangs of Messiah come to pass in Isaiah's day. But how many know Isaiah didn't just prophesy of his day? He prophesied of our day. And as we see the signs in the heavens, we're supposed to get ready. How do we get ready? Do we hide? No. We actually shine more in the midst of a dark season. I love that. Love it. Now, I close with these last words from the commentary that we were reading earlier. It says, the Torah continues. I think this is going to be a revelation for somebody. The Torah continues. It says, she shall be ritually unclean for how many days?
Seven.
Speaking of a pregnant woman. What did Israel liken themselves to?
Pregnant.
A pregnant woman. Describing the extent to which the mother contracts ritual impurity as a result of giving birth. Here the Torah alludes to the way Hashem initiates a process which culminates in the rehabilitation of Israel so that it, speaking of her like a mother, remember Sarah who bore you, right? That heavenly Jerusalem is like a mother, right? It says, so that it will attain a spiritual level that qualifies for the description masculine. So notice that here it's saying that there's a rehabilitation from the Israel that's like a mother that's in pain and unclean for 7 days because she's given a male child. Remember the book of Revelation? There was a woman in heaven, 12 stars around her head. She was having birth pains. And all of a sudden it says she produced a male child. The birth pains of Messiah is not Messiah being born again in a manger. The birth pains of Messiah is referring to the 144,000 that are caught up to God, because it says the child is caught up to God, because God is preparing His precious Jewish people, not just from the tribe of Judah, but from all 12 tribes. He is restoring back the house of Israel. And what He's going to do, watch this. If you read on, it says the days mentioned here are to be understood as 7 years.
Amen.
What's the tribulation period?
7 years.
Similar to the verse in Genesis 24:55, where Laban and his mother wanted Rebekah to delay her departure by Yamin, Hebrew for days, a year. The years which are viewed as the 7, as the birth pains of Mashiach. Did you hear that?
Yep.
The birth pains of Mashiach last for 7 years, during which Israel will be refined spiritually in preparation for His revival.
Right.
His arrival. Well, revival too.
Yes.
Now let me see if you caught all this. This is amazing. This is absolutely amazing to me. In fact, let me keep reading because I think it'll be clearer on the next slide. The years which are viewed as the birth pangs of Mashiach, the Messiah, will last for how many years?
7.
This is Orthodox, guys. This is not the book of Revelation. This is Orthodox Judaism. He says it's viewed as the birth pangs of Mashiach. They last how many years?
7 years.
For 7 years, during which Israel will be refined spiritually in preparation for His arrival. He will make His appearance during the 8th year, meaning at the close of 7, the new beginning is the 8th year, which is the final concept of Jubilee.
Pretty awesome.
Yes, it is pretty awesome. This is absolutely awesome. Wait for next week. So now, it says, He will make His appearance during the 8th year, that's the beginning of the millennium, on the 8th day, at the beginning of the 8th day, meaning year, the baby is to have his foreskin removed. The concept of a foreskin which acts as a barrier between man and Hashem will be removed from the universe. In other words, there will no longer be a barrier between the intimacy that the bride can have with her groom, that God can have with his people, that God can remove the barrier. Because on the eighth day is the circumcision. So guess what? 7 days and then the eighth day. That the Torah is more than a literal Peshat level. There is a spiritual, mystical, mysterious, messianic revelation in the Torah that we have not yet understood. For the Bible said the way we know that the birth pangs of Messiah are close and that the footsteps of Messiah are here is when the revelation of Torah begins to go from natural to spiritual. When Israel is redefined and Israel starts reading the Torah again and realizing that every commandment, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little, is all giving them a revelation from babes to mature men. I'm over time, but let me give you my 3 points I want you to think about. I didn't even give you the fill-in. I forgot to give you a space to fill it in. So just walk away with these points. Our ears must listen to the Torah as we hear what? The heels of Messiah, meaning that he's coming. Our eyes must see the signs of his coming as we open our hearts to him. And number 3, our heels must crush the enemy as Messiah's footsteps draw closer. Yeah. See, the Bible says the enemy will be crushed underneath your feet. Amen. Messiah defeated him, but he's going to be crushed on your feet. How many received this message today?
Yes. Yes.
How many ready for next week? To see how the footsteps of Messiah lead to the footstool of Messiah, which are found in the feasts of Messiah. Amen. Let's stand today and let's receive the blessing. Next week, starting actually tomorrow, you're going to talk about our study, blessing, obedience, be careful, understand what's unclean versus clean. You're going to learn how to prosper. You're going to learn about the release of the Shemitah, 7-year cycle, and then we're going to feast with Messiah at his festival. The enemy will be at his footstool, or we'll be at his festival table. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stretch our hands for the blessing today.
Thank you.
Yivarachacha Adonai v'yishmerecha Ya'er Adonai p'nav elecha v'hundecha Yisa Adonai p'nav elecha Be'aselecha shalom. Amen. May the Lord Adonai bless and keep you. May he shed his face upon you and be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you perfect peace and sar shalom, the Prince of Peace. In the name of Yeshua the Messiah we pray. B'shem Yeshua. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you today.
May the Lord bless you and keep you, and make his face to shine upon you, and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you. May the Lord grant you his peace. Yiverechecha Adonai, v'yishmerecha, Ya'er Adonai, p'nav elecha v'hunecha. Adonai p'nav elecha v'yaseh lecha shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and make his face to shine upon you, and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you. May the Lord grant you his peace. Yiverechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha, Ya'er Adonai p'nav elecha v'hunecha. Yisa Adonai p'nav elecha v'yaseh lecha shalom.